I'd like to welcome everyone today to the residency of Meredith Monk as our Trotter visiting professor. And she is actually our first digital Trotter visiting professor. We welcome you to our community today. We're just so thrilled.
Thank you. I'm so glad to be here. Thank you very much.
Before we begin, I'd like to give a brief introduction to say to those of you who know her well, you probably will know most of what I'm going to say, but I know we have many people joining from around the world, and I'd like everybody to know these very important things about Meredith before we begin. She is one of the great artists of our time, a composer, singer, director, choreographer, and creator of new opera, music, theater, works, films, and installations. And she is one of the most unique and influential artists of our time, a pioneer in what's called now extended vocal techniques and interdisciplinary performance. Her work is groundbreaking in every respect. She explores the voice as an instrument, and her work is an eloquent language in and of itself, a language without words, a language of feelings, energies, and memories. She is celebrated internationally, and her work has been presented and continues to be presented throughout the world. And recently, she's been honored in many ways with, in fact, the very highest honors bestowed to a living artist in the United States. Induction into the American Academy of Arts and Letters in 2019, the Dorothy and Lillian Gish Prize in 2017, and in 2015, presented by President Barack Obama, the National Medal of Arts. We welcome you today, Meredith, and are so grateful for your generosity and being with us, and
Thank you.
Very much looking forward to this conversation. We'll start with an hour-long conversation, and then we'll open it up, and we have questions from our students from the Oregon Composers Forum. Great. I'd like to begin by asking you, what are your earliest memories and how do they play a part in your work even today?
My earliest memories or my earliest musical memories?
Actually, keep that open.
Well, why I was asking that is I think my earliest memory is, this is going to sound so strange, but I think my earliest memory was hearing a garbage truck. Because I grew up in Queens for the first 7 years of my life. And I do remember that, you know, hearing that sound. I come from a musical family. I'm the fourth generation singer in my family. My mother was a singer on radio. So who originally sang in what they, I guess they used to have a variety show kind of formats. And so she did some of the ballads and, you know, she was very versatile. She sang, classical music, but I mean, in those days it was more popular music, but she could do the more, what I say, semi-classical songs, but then also more crooning. But then later on, she became a jingle singer. So she was, and in those days they didn't have tape. So she was going in to New York. So we were living in Queens. She was going into New York to sing the same commercial every day at 1 o'clock in the afternoon called DUZ Does Everything, which is a soap commercial on a soap opera. And so I heard her singing, you know, I'm a very early memory of her singing me Danny Boy, actually, I remember that. And then my grandfather was a singer who had come from Russia. He was a bass baritone. And then his father apparently was a cantor in Russia. So the singing voice and music was something very, very was introduced to me. I'm so grateful for it. You know, music was definitely as natural to me as breathing. You know, singing was as natural as breathing. So that's my earliest memories of music.
That makes so much sense to me. I really feel that in your work today. And that's what I was wondering. There seems to be this through line, this connection to the voice that is so alive in every work. And in that sense, I'd like to ask you about your music and interdisciplinary art. And how do you regard it as an embodiment of your inner voice?
Well, I think, I started, my early training was in Dalcroze Eurythmics. And for the people that are out there that don't know what it is, it's a system of teaching music, mostly for children, although I think conductors study it and, you know, adults study it as well. But it's kind of a synesthetic way of working on music, because Dalcroze was a composer in Switzerland in the late 19th century. And he writes about having trouble teaching one particular student rhythm. But he observed that student had a very great graceful way of walking. And so he just started developing exercises for the body, rhythmic exercises for the body, and started working with that student. And the student actually started getting rhythm, understanding the way that rhythm worked. And so he developed a kind of a pedagogical system that dealt with rhythmic training embodied. So, you know, it's a lot of movement, improvisation, and then also teaching what's called the solfege method, which is the do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. But you see how I'm doing it? That's how I learned it. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. So you were hearing it and you were using your arms going up. So you started hearing sound in space. And so I think for me, I had some coordination problems as a child. And I think for me, learning music, which for me was very comfortable, but learning music with the body was the way that I learned the body. And I think that some of the other children were learning, they were more comfortable in their bodies, but they were learning music through their bodies. So, you know, it had that kind of integrative way of thinking about things. And as the years have gone by, I realized more and more how much that's influenced me. And then I was dancing a lot as a child and I was in theater. And so I went to Sarah Lawrence and I asked them if I could do a combined performing arts program. So my senior year, I was in the voice department. I was doing music composition. I was doing dance and dance composition and theater. And they let me do 2/3 of my program in performing arts. And so I knew that somehow it was almost like a psychic sense that I needed to find a way to weave these aspects together to actually feel whole as a person. And so then I started already starting to work on compositions that wove together music, movement, and objects and visual images while I was still in school. I had glimpses of it.
That makes so much sense to me, because your work is so organic, and the process that you're describing from your earliest memories is very, very organic. And it seems to me that it's very much alive in all of your work. I'd like to ask you about the social and political embodiment of your voice through
your work. I feel like my work is always has a kind of oblique social and political aspect to it, but because I'm making these big weaves, it becomes one strand in the weave. There are some pieces that I've made over the years that you could say are more overtly dealing with the social world. For example, Quarry, which was an opera that I made in 1976, was inspired by World War II and dictatorship. The Games was another piece that was a collaboration that I did with Ping Chong. Again, we were in Berlin, so it was about dictatorship. That aspect is there, but it's never, I wouldn't say that my work is overtly political. I'm trying to go more for the timeless nature of human behavior and the way that things cycle around over and over again, that these things come and they come again. And that part of our awareness as human beings is seeing them come up again, you know, that the same patterns come up again and then try to work with them. So that's the way I've been thinking about it. But I know that when I came to New York and I was making solo pieces in galleries and I was, again, trying to weave these elements together. I first thought that it was something that came from the inner world of integration, but I realized early on that it also had a social aspect, because it's only the Western European tradition that isolates the art forms or the perceptions. And if you think about African culture or Asian theater forms or accounts of ancient theatrical or performance forms that are spiritual practices, all those elements are woven together. It's not like you have to just be like a dancer or a singer or a composer or a storyteller. The more aspects that are in one body, the more honored you are. Whereas in the Western European tradition, there's some kind of fear about if you do all these things, then you must not do any of them well. And that is a real misunderstanding, because actually, in fact, you have to do all of them well, and you have to work harder, you know? So I realized that was a way of offering something that was a counterbalance to the fragmentation of our world, and trying to offer something that was really use the full perceptual modalities of us as human beings, both as performers and as audience members.
You know, I've noticed in so many of your pieces, this very quality that you're describing, especially in your interdisciplinary art, but in the music as well. For me, it has a feeling of ritual and ceremony.
Yes.
And I'm wondering, how that relates to your exploration over the course of your entire life, the exploration of cycles and cyclic structures as related to ritual and ceremony in particular. How does that resonate for you, and how is it a living out of certain spiritual aspects of ritual and ceremony?
Yeah, well, I think ritual is something that's very important. I've thought about it all the way through my life and in my work, because ritual has to do with being aware of what you're doing. It's you know, it's concentrating energy. And so, I mean, I remember, you know, this is a humorous aspect. I remember doing a piece called Vessel in the early 70s, and we had this thing called the salad ritual. So the performers were on this kind of mountain, and each of them, so they would hold up their bowl, each person had their own way of doing it, which was really beautiful. And then they'd put the bowl down, and then everybody would hold up their lettuce. And then you just hear this like, and they'd be, you know, and then it would be the tomato, you know, and the knife. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was sort of that thing of, and there are many cultures that have food rituals, but, you know, just that it's kind of a sense of awareness of things that we take for granted. And also I like the structure of ritual for a performance, because I feel that it allows us, for example, to watch each other. It's not trying to do an illusion, and, you know, it's creating a kind of world of magic, but it's not trying to do an illusion, because, you know, it has much more to do with presence. Does that make any sense?
It makes so much sense. And having to be in the moment, because ritual and ceremony are grounded in the moment. And,
exactly.
And that's one of the essential aspects of your work that I think draws us so much to the work.
And I love the thing of what I like about ritual too, is that I think it invites the audience in a different way. It's sort of more, the audience is more, it's kind of, you know, I'm sort of interested these last years is the very, very thin line between audience and congregation, you could say.
Yes. Well, there's sense in what you were just saying of bringing people together, a kind of celebration of unity through ritual and ceremony, because of course, initially, if we go way back, that is exactly why ceremony and ritual were created, is to bring people together. But I think that for me, and I'm wondering if you would agree, that in your works where you have an ensemble, there's this sense of actually expressing to the audience this aspect of unity in the way that the members of the ensemble behave towards each other in the course of the work.
Yeah, I mean, I think performance is such a remarkable, magical situation, because in a way, it can be a template of human behavior. Because with the people that I work with, and I've worked with them for so many years, it's like the trust and the generosity and the sensitivity and the vulnerability is actually embodied in the performance itself. And in a strange way, even if I'm working on a different theme, like the last piece that I worked on was called Cellular Songs, and it was five women. And yes, it was very inspired by cellular activity. And, you know, I would say the motor of life, because the cell is the most essential unit, you know, in the universe. But, you know, I feel the real theme was the behavior of us towards each other in our in that community of performers. And I think that the audience got that. You know, it was like, this is possible, you know, cooperation rather than competition, and kindness and gentleness, and not in a sappy way, because, you know, still, I think there's a kind of rigor to it, but, you know, not in a sentimental way, because, you know, sentimentality is actually not feeling. It's not the same as feeling, but just in the activity. And also the music is so complex to sing and so interdependent and really labor intensive. And you kind of sense that, you know, that everybody had to roll up their sleeves to be able to sing this, and hours and hours and hours and hours of work went into being able to sing this. And we lean on each other, like in the best sense of the word, you know? And so I think that that's why I believe in live performance so much, you know, because I feel that other than meditation or enlightenment, it's, you know, or going to church, you know, or temple, or, you know, whatever those rituals are, I think that it is this place where, you know, we are, the energy is a kind of figure eight or a sort of infinity sign between the performers, who are very vulnerable, and you sense that, you know, it's a tightrope kind of situation, and the audience, and the energy is going back and forth and back and forth. And so it's the time where we can all be in the same space at the same time.
Well, hearing you speak about it, and especially about how ritual and ceremony are very much in the moment, and this kind of feeling of being totally present, which I think your work certainly invites us into, that living space of being totally present and alive. Now I'd like to ask you about dreams and how your work relates to dreams and to waking dreams, to your own, but also, is there an aspect of your work that in fact, some of the pieces at least are waking dreams, are an embodiment of a waking dream?
Well, I love the syntax of dreams. You know, sometimes if I'm teaching a workshop, we work on dream syntax, you know, which is a different kind of continuity than our usual awareness. And there's something about that that has a truth to it. But I can think of two different times that I literally had dreams where they made their way into a piece. So one of them was an image from Education of the Girl Child, where there's a death character that walks in within three different incarnations. And in one of them, she's got these, so the dream that I had was of somebody coming up the elevator into my loft, and the person had these little shiny kind of emerald-like figures, little tiny people like sitting on her shoulders and up on her head and in her hands. And so that in Education of the Girl Child, the figures were blue, but we made little puppets on her, you know, on her shoulders and up on her head and like in her hands. So that was one direct connection. And another one was a sound one, where in A Book of Days, I actually dreamt of these voices. Probably it was maybe a nightmare, but you know, it's part of a piece called Plague in Book of Days, where these voices are going, "We know who you are. We know what you've done. We know who you are." And And somehow, you know, it worked its way into this piece called Plague. So those are very literal dream images that went right into the work. But that hasn't happened so much these last years. But I think it's just more somehow the, you know, that knowing that what our waking consciousness is not the only thing that exists. I would, you know, that sense that there are all these other levels that are happening as we live. And I maybe one other little extension of that, I made a piece called Magic Frequencies at the end of the 90s, and it was a piece about, well, magic frequencies are the frequencies that are in the, they're related to the hydrogen atom, and that it's what SETI they send these frequencies, radio frequencies, into the universe in hopes that there would be intelligent life that would be able to get those messages. And they're always, and the ones that they send are attached to the hydrogen element, element, because that's the most prevalent in the universe. And those are called magic frequencies. And the piece, and I also was reading somewhere that the stars are always singing, but we don't hear them. And so the piece is about, it's a very surreal kind of piece about, you know, things that in very ordinary, there are these very ordinary kinds of scenes, but these invisible and kind of inaudible aspects that may be going on now are, you know, brought up into the, into consciousness. So.
It's so exciting to hear you talk about this. You mentioned your work is, you're reaching toward the timeless. It's an expression of the timeless. And then you use the word universal in describing an aspect of your work a moment ago. I'm wondering how all of this relates to any spiritual practice that you might have, or some form of meditation or reflection. How does that play into the creative process of bringing these works to life?
I've been a Buddhist practitioner for many years, since the mid 70s. And but I really started really practicing formally in the mid 80s. And I used to think that it did, you know, that that was over here and my art was over here. But as the years have gone by, you know, I just feel like they just have melded. And as a young artist, I believe that these principles that I thought of as aesthetic principles were something that I intuitively was connected to. But then knowing more about the Buddhist practice and thinking and you know, way of thinking about things, I realized at a certain point that those aspects that were my goals in my aesthetic, in my artwork, were fundamental Buddhist principles like immediacy and fluidity of time and space and presence. You know, there are many of them. And so as I've gone on over the years, I think that I, you know, feel comfortable saying that that art is a spiritual practice for me. And that even going more into the themes that I would be afraid of, because, you know, it in a way, in those early days, if you ever talked about this stuff, you were seen as a kind of, what would I say, new age, you know, hoochie coochie, which I hated also. I couldn't stand it, you know, and it didn't have rigor. It wasn't intellectual enough, da, 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 da. You know, but these years I'm thinking, you know, I love this idea that making art is also a way of contemplating. So I love the idea of making pieces that you can't make pieces about, you know, with themes that you can't make pieces about, like mercy, impermanence, you know, and they're called mercy, impermanence, songs of ascension, Indra's net is what I'm working on now, cellular songs. I mean, just these themes that you can contemplate as part of your practice of making an art piece. And so I just feel like, you know, time is going by and I'd rather just, you know, feel that it seems very appropriate to state it as like a way of working.
I can really feel the theme of spiritual practice throughout your
work. I do believe art is spiritual practice. Ultimately, I think for, you know, really ultimately, I think for every artist in one way or another, you know, it has that, I've devoted my life to it, you know, and I think that even if maybe someone's not aware of it, just the that sense of focus and trying to make something that has truth, it, you know, is a spiritual practice.
Yeah, and art is a way of life.
And it's a way of life, yeah.
And as related to spiritual practice. And I'm wondering about, as related to archetype as well, because in watching so many of your pieces and experiencing them, I noticed the connection to archetypes that give life to the entire embodiment that's occurring of various internal processes. And do you relate to your work that way as being related to particular archetypes? And if so, which ones?
I think not in particular ways, but I feel like certainly my early work was very involved with that. And Again, I think it was a impulse to try to make something that has a kind of universality about it. I mean, I think now people are doing some very deep thinking about this, you know, about Jungian thinking. And there was a while where, you know, nobody wanted to talk about it because I think there was some strange twist about, it had something to do with culture, you know, which I don't understand because my understanding of archetype was always that it has to do with that every culture, for example, has a mother, you know, every culture has a soldier, you know, that archetypes are these universal kinds of human types that exist in every culture. And so that was always what I was trying for, you know, something that goes beneath, you know, that everybody could understand in a way, even though, of course, our cultures are very specific and they should be honored. You know, our specificity of culture, background, race, gender, all that specificity is something very important to honor, to explore, you know, because I'm sure I feel that we have to know what that is before we can find what our commonalities are, but, and, you know, affirm those differences before we can really, you know, get to that generosity of commonality. But I feel like my impulse has always been to be as inclusive as possible. And what I'm going for as the final goal is commonalities and commonality.
I wonder about archetypes such as, for example, the archetype of simply light, and how for example, that light as an archetype, how that would play into your work from the very beginning of your creative journey in the world, because I see that as a theme throughout, and I'm wondering if that's a conscious theme or how it relates to your spiritual practice or in any other way to your life.
I've always thought of archetypes more in terms of people.
Into the people.
Light.
For example, if I look at the interdisciplinary art, that's what's so amazing is the, for example, light is very much part of it. And
yes, of course. I mean, being very conscious of light. I mean, light is definitely one of the perceptual elements, you know, for sure, and very carefully thought through. I have a wonderful designer, Joe Levasseur, who I'm working with right now. And I've had wonderful designers in the past, Beverly Emmons and Tony Giovanetti. I mean, Noel Stolmach. I mean, just wonderful designers, you know, that I love to work with light, of course, you know, as a visual element. And I guess you're asking that in relation to that, you know, a lot of times musicians don't think in those terms. I guess that's what, you know, because I noticed years ago, when I went to music concerts that I, you know, visually, it wasn't very satisfying to me. And so even when we do music concerts, I'm very, very, very aware of working with, we always do beautiful lighting for the, and what we're wearing is also part of just a music concert, just so that the visual experience is satisfying and that we're not cutting out one sense. So, you know, perhaps from that point of view is what you're asking about light.
And also how it relates to the perception of space.
Well, space is, you know, as I say to my students, space is your ally. So I think what's very interesting in the Western European tradition, the Western European tradition in music, like say in voice, you know, the training doesn't include space particularly. Even though like in, you know, in the opera house, you're supposed to project over the orchestra and everything, but space is not part of the training. And I think that space is something that as instrumentalists, as you know, singers, and of course as movers and as actors, I mean, that's your big ally is space. So my work is always related to space. And the piece I'm working on right now, Indra's Net, which is going to be a large performance/installation piece. It's so spatial that during this pandemic time, it's been really hard to work on it because space is so much the way I'm thinking. You know, I'm really thinking in terms of, you know, this antiphonal thing, and I want the instrument. So, you know, that's how I'm thinking in terms of the music. And so it's been really sad, like to have to only be working on Zoom and only working musically not, I love working musically, but I mean, without us being in the same room, it's been very, very challenging. And I just can't wait until we can get to it again.
Yeah, well,
but I think that also comes from Dalcroze, the Dalcroze training, because it's always moving in space. You know, the thing is so beautiful about Dalcroze, that, I mean, I always rant and rave about it because I'm so glad that was my early training. And I always tell like parents, send your kids to Dalcroze to start out. There's a little music school down the street from me here in New York called Church Street School of Music and Art. And the woman who's the director teaches Dalcroze. And we've taught, she's sent me videotapes of the teaching. And these children, I mean, they're so comfortable singing and reading music by the time they end up working on their individual instruments and so comfortable in their bodies and how that works with music that they learn instruments 1, 2, 3 much faster than kids that haven't had that training. It's a wonderful thing. And as I said, conductors study it too, because you're beating 5 with one hand and 9 with another, it's all that coordination thing too, which conductors need to have. So
yeah, Dalcroze is an amazing practice.
Yeah.
I've known so many musicians that have engaged in it at some point. And
it's miraculous.
Yeah, it really is. And in terms of your own work, the integration of movement
yes. Is
also so crucial. And how do you relate the actual style of movement or the actual working out of movement within a certain piece? Does it emerge from the music itself, or does the movement emerge from the music, or is it a dynamic between those things?
Well, each piece is really different, but these last years, because the music, my trajectory, I came to New York kind of as a dancer who sang, and then the music just started going and took over everything, but movement is still very important to me. I mean, I keep moving every day, and but most of my these years, it's more the music comes first. But because I came from a movement background, which was very helpful, I'm not sure I would have gotten to the way that I sing, which I consider a kind of kinetic way of thinking about the voice, without my movement background. And then the way that I work, I mean, I sit at the piano every day and vocalize every day, and I write things down, but I'm not a composer that sits and writes a score out. I just don't work that way, and I don't even like to score a piece particularly before, completely finish the form before I go into rehearsal. And I think that comes from my dance background, because I like to come in with material and then I actually work it out on the people, physically, vocally and, musically, and then go back and work alone again, and then work out my structure again and come back into, I prefer that embodied way of working. When I've done orchestra pieces or instrumental pieces, because that discipline, especially orchestra, where they only get 2 rehearsals, I mean, our process is labor intensive. People are so patient with me, my performers, but what happens because of that is it goes right into the bone, and it does eliminate one step of memorizing what's on a page. And we don't use scores in performance, really. And I would like to have orchestras do my pieces without scores, but because of the financial thing, it's very hard. So I've had to work on scores and hand them in. And, I find that, I just don't feel, it's not as tactile for me. I feel like I'm molding, like sculpting music. I think that comes from coming both from a music and movement background. But in terms of the way that the movement works with the music, I use it in very different ways. I think that sometimes it parallels and sometimes it's a counterpoint. I love the way of using music movement as a kind of counterpoint. So, it's a different relationship, in each piece of the, it's more, these years, I think of it more as gesture in relation to, the music.
Yeah, I think that whole aspect of movement and movement in music and music in movement, that dynamic, I experienced that in, all of your works in one way or another. Also this aspect of the inner voice becoming an outer expression, and then the outer voice influencing the development of the inner. There's this dynamic between internal and external, interior, you could say, realization or revelation, and then external embodiment. Mm-hmm. But that's part of a continuum rather than being two separative states.
Right. And I, that's why I always say my process is a lot of time alone, you know, sometimes years before I even go into rehearsal with all my ideas and my musical phrases and, you know, like sketches, you know, coming in with sketches, but I don't like it. I you know, the moment where I have to set it in stone is always a very sad moment for me, because I always feel like I come in with potential, you know, that's, you know, and that it's fluid. And then when it's time for it to, and that, you know, then it becomes this form. And I always feel like at that moment, something gets lost, you know, because the possibility isn't in there anymore. But I think the thing that's beautiful about, again, about live performance is that as we perform it, it starts having its own life, because we find out more about it as it goes along, and it starts, you know, morphing into, you know, it changes a little bit as we go along and perform it over and over again. And so it's alive. And, you know, I going back to the score thing, I think I read somewhere that Debussy kept on changing his scores. So, you know, that's what it, you know, it's a live thing. The dots on the page are just, they're like little symbols of something, but the something is something else. And, you know, I always feel like the dots on the page in my music, it just simplifies it too much, because it doesn't show the principles that are underlying and how you perform it and how you sing it and how it is embodied. You can't show that on paper. So that always, you know, is kind of a little level of frustration for me, but I, you know, work with it the best I can, because the beautiful thing about scores is that that's a way you can remember at least the overall forms. And it is a way of communicating when you can't spend all that time with people, you know, it's a way that we communicate.
Well, there's that question, can meaning be notated?
Meaning, or I would say more like principles, you know, principles. Or the principles, like the underlying principles of how you actually sing this, that are is very hard to even describe in words without direct transmission.
Yeah. And that, of course,
which is an oral tradition, which is more an oral tradition idea. Yeah.
Yeah, and you've mentioned that before, how your relationship to words is very unique and special and particular to your art, that rather than using words, the music comes out of, you could say, other principles and other qualities of life that don't necessarily have verbal expressions.
Yeah, I think, because coming from a movement background, I trust the nonverbal communication. I love words. I love writing. I love talking. You know, I went to Sarah Lawrence. If one thing you learn at Sarah Lawrence is how to talk, if nothing else, because you have these individual conference classes with your teacher. So you have to articulate your ideas. But I don't know. I just trust that nonverbal communication is so deep, and also, what it's allowed us to do is to go around the world and sing the music, and people receive it in a direct way rather than having to work through the filter of language. You know, so again, I think it, some of, and then some of my pieces do have words, but they're usually done in a, they're never like the narrative exactly. They're more like litany, you know, or lists or something where, again, it has more ritualistic quality, more abstract quality rather than a narrative. And then with those words, because they're repetitive, we can just put them in the program, or I could, you know, for example, one of my pieces called The Tale, usually I sing it, it's a repetitive thing of an old woman. I still have my hands, I still have my mind, I still have my this, I still have my that. And because it's repetitive like that, I can learn it in the language that I'm in. And then the audience just kind of goes crazy because me doing it in Cantonese or, you know, Czech or, you know, I mean, but I write it out phonetically and I have it on the piano, you know, so I can do my best. And I think even that attempt makes people feel good. I remember in one of the pieces in Cellular Songs, the only one that has words is called Happy Woman. And I remember I was in Russia, of all places, where my grandfather came from. That's pretty hard to, you know, I was more frightened about singing the, you know, some of those words in Russian than probably the whole piece. And I remember I sang it in Russian, and you know, in Russia, people, there aren't a lot of people that speak English. And people just went berserk when they heard the Russian, you know, so it's again, a way of connecting. I mean, I feel that art is about connecting. And that's why, you know, somebody was saying to me, isn't that a essential, shouldn't we be considered essential workers? And I think so, you know, I don't think that, you know, the overall population thinks so, but you could say that it's essential work because it's about connecting. It's about connecting people.
I would say,
to me, that's what art is about to me.
Yeah, in that sense, it's among the most essential work that's being done because we need that more than ever right now.
We really do. Mm-hmm.
When you think about what we've all learned living in isolation, the way we have, and people, of course, isolation is one word, but there are many ways to live that out. And my next question has to do with the creative energy of solitude. And I know that you live in solitude for a significant part of every year. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to ask you how that's influenced your life and your work.
Well, my favorite solitude place is land in New Mexico, northern New Mexico, which is near Abiquiu, New Mexico. And I have like a one room, you could say like studio, that's it. Which has a kitchen and bathroom, but I mean, it's just this one room. And I go there 3 months a year, you know, not 3 months in a row, but 3 months a year. And that is where I feel like I'm the most connected to my inner voice. And I can hear myself think. I write a lot of my music there. And I love the danger and the kind of primordial quality of nature there. Like I feel that the kind of perspective of knowing that I'm a tiny, tiny little grain of sand in this landscape that is does quite well without me and human beings. You know, it's just that perspective is, you know, just is really important to me. And also the expansiveness of the landscape. You know, New York is a very, you could say might be the opposite, you know. So just the feeling nature and its power renews me, you know, and it's so I think of them as kind of music meditation retreats. So I'm also able to practice there more, my meditation practice, and write my music and basically hear myself think. I don't know if you feel that way too, but because I know you go there too. You're a neighbor.
we're very close in terms of a geographical area. We're really within the same ecosystem, but different sides of it. But it's really
so part to the audience. We just found this out before we started this interview that we both go to these. We're like a half an hour away from each other area. So you know, it's kind of was a revelation. I think another thing that I love so much about that area is it's very, in a way, dinosaurs could be walking in that land. I mean, I've always felt that way. I mean, it's kind of timeless, and the rock formations, you see the strata of millions of years and millions of years and millions of years. And you sense that the land that I think it was the bottom of the ocean.
Yes, it
was. So it's something about the vastness and the timelessness and the ancient quality of that land that has always inspired me for many, many years. My sister was living there since the 1970s. And she's there also a few months a year. So it's also a chance that I get to see her. But, you know, it's a very inspiring place.
I totally agree. And what you just said about the dinosaurs and about the mesas and being able to look at the geological slices of time, and then that becomes an experience of timelessness because you realize that time is relative in a certain sense and one's perception to it during our lifespan and then the lifespan of this ecosystem, which is so incredible, just so expansive. And in every direction, there's this sense of being able to see the horizon and even beyond the horizon when the stars come out at night, which is one of my favorite things there, is to be able to look up into the heavens because there's no light from the surface that's blocking one's view.
Well, in the valley that I'm in, there's a lot of bears. And so I'm alone out there. And so sometimes I don't go out at night because there's also a mountain lion out there. I wish I could go out and see the stars more, but if a neighbor comes by, then we sit outside. But, you know, I mean, well, again, that's so amazing. You know, I mean, I'm contending with bears and something just fell down off my ceiling. So I'm contending with bears and a mountain lion. I mean, there's something amazing about that.
There definitely is. And I've had my adventures with both. I've had an encounter with a bear.
Mountain lion. I had an encounter with a bear.
Yeah. And with tarantulas, animals that you don't see, all of them together, I don't think anywhere else. I mean, everything, the different kinds of snakes, of course, the rattlesnakes.
Rattlesnakes, lots of rattlesnakes, yeah.
Very dangerous. Then I had an encounter with a fox that came up. I was playing music in the place where I was living and on a digital keyboard. And I looked out the window and there was a fox listening.
Ooh, that's so beautiful.
And looking at me. And I realized that the fox maybe had never heard music before. Or what was that? And was transfixed. And I stopped and looked at the fox and we held our gaze for a long time. And then the fox started to tear up.
Oh my gosh.
It was incredible. It was this feeling of closeness to this animal and through extension to all of the life in that ecosystem. Yeah. And then the fox, in the calmest way, just walked off.
Oh my goodness.
So that's the kind of magic that happens there. They call it the land of enchantment, of course, New Mexico.
Yeah. I had something a little bit like that when because there's cliffs on land and I was climbing. Originally there, now there are more dogs, but originally there were definitely coyotes and they were calling back and forth from the cliffs. And I walked up around 1 o'clock in the afternoon and I started singing a piece called Offering, you know, which is a kind of high, just a melody. And they answered me. I think I woke them up from their siesta. Oh, it was so incredible. You know, it was just incredible. So, you know, I think it makes our little problems, you know, it puts our little problems and our, you know, and the way that we're so concerned about ourselves into a perspective that's, you know, really illuminating. And, you know, one can do that in different kinds of, you know, in meditation practice too, you know, it's an internal process, but somehow there is something about the environment, you know, that just, everything, you know, that seems so important suddenly doesn't seem so important.
That's so true.
And that can be very inspiring.
Yeah, there's a sense of expansiveness of all life there. And this, you really feel that connection in a very direct and primal way.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you also about what are your greatest hopes for how your art ideally would affect the lives of those who experience it in the largest sense of that, the connection that you individually feel with the lives of all those who will ever hear it or experience your interdisciplinary art pieces, what would be your greatest hope for what they would be receiving from that?
Nowadays is that people will just be inspired to know that they're basically good, you know, that there is basically basic goodness in the world. Again, as I said before, you know, that it's a kind of prototype of the possibility of human behavior. And I would just hope that that is inspiring to people right now, you know, because it's a very dark time. I would just like people to know that they can follow their dreams, that they have everything that they need within them, and that, you know, they can trust their instincts, and you know, that art is a kind of healing It is one healing aspect of the world.
Well, and there's and that sense of,
their, you know, and to quiet down a little bit and slow down a little bit.
Yeah, there's that sense of personal healing. And I wonder about in terms of the concept of tikkun olam, meaning repair or repairing the world, and how you might relate to that, because I do sense that impulse in and through your work.
Yeah, I can relate to it. I think even more and more as I go along, you know, because there was a certain point that I called my apocalyptic period where I felt that it was very important to state the problem. You know, something that Brecht said, Bertolt Brecht, he said an amazing thing. Now, I don't know where we sort of seem to be distorting here, but I don't know what's going on. But anyway.
Technology.
Yeah, technology. He said something like, will there be singing in the dark times? Yes, something like, yes, we will sing about the dark times. You know, I mean, it's something about, yes, it's something that came to me when We Will Not Discuss His Name was elected. And I went into my, you know, concentration camp, you know, scenario. And I was thinking, because I knew that there was going to be a lot of suffering that was going to happen, you know, particularly to people of color and Jewish people and, you know, people that are not down the middle, what they call the middle lane. And I thought, would I sing to the very end, you know, if it would make it that other people were, you know, had some comfort from it. And I thought, yeah, I would. And also that, you know, we have to be quietly stubborn, I was saying to myself. And, you know, I do think that it is a kind of antidote, you know, to the poison that we're being fed. I feel like there is a light at the end of the tunnel right now, but you know, that we were being fed. So during the time that I was, my apocalyptic period, which I would say was a piece called Recent Ruins was one. One was called Specimen Days, which was about the Civil War and about dualistic thinking. One was The Games, which I made with Ping Chong. And one was called Turtle Dreams Cabaret, which was like an apocalyptic cabaret. I was thinking that stating the problem was really important. And Quarry was certainly that as well. But then a certain time I realized, no, I actually think people know what the problem is, at least the people that are going to come to you know, these pieces. And because I'm a nonverbal artist, someone like Brecht could delineate this, you know, in a way that's useful for people's thinking. But I'm not sure that's where I don't know if that's my strong point, you know, because I'm basically a nonverbal artist, you know. Mm-hmm. So I started thinking about, you know, what would be the alternate or alternative to stating the problem and creating what I would call, you know, sacred space, you know, as a performance. And that's what I've done since then, you know, so.
I have one more question for you before we go to the students' questions. And it's a question actually that I've been asking myself lately, which is at this point during our individual and communal experiences of isolation during the pandemic times. You know, what have I learned? And also, what has the pandemic and isolation during the pandemic taught me? That kind of.
Are you asking that to yourself or are you asking me?
Well, I'm saying that I asked myself first and now I'm asking you. I wanted to share that with you and see what you might have to say with it.
I feel like I and all of us have gone through many different phases. I would say probably the thing that I keep on thinking these days, because it's been so long, is I think it's it's been a real lesson in patience. Because, you know, this Indra's Net piece, I've been working on it for 10 years. And we were right in the middle of, we were just beginning our rehearsal process. And it was so exciting. And I'm so excited about the ideas. Then this, you know, this hit, and what would have taken, you know, and we were actually supposed to premiere it at Mills College last November. So it would have taken 6 months to to embody and to make into a form is now one 10-minute section. It has taken 6 months. You know, and so some days when I'm having, you know, like more challenging days, I just, you know, sigh a lot. But as they say in the I Ching, perseverance furthers. And, you know, and I think I've always been patient in the long run. I'm a little more impatient as a person in the short run, but now I have to learn patience in the short run. So I think that's what I've learned, you know, is just do my best, you know, to make this come to life in any way that I can, you know, because I you know, and try not to unravel. I think that's what we're all trying for, you know. And also, I think another thing that has been, you know, really beautiful is I think all of us have also learned what's really important to us. And for example, I talk to my sister every night, you know, and we would never have done that. You know, we have a phone conversation every single night. And to know that she's even out there in the world and cares, you know, cares, and that we're, you know, sisters, we never would have done that. You know, so I feel like there is something where things get sifted down to, you know, the most important things in life. And there's, you know, new communities that have been formed during this time that we would never be able to have. And so we're just doing the best. But that is not to say that all of us as performers are just, you know, grieving, you know, and waiting to get in the same room at the same time. And the concert that we're doing on Sunday for you know, the university is, we literally are doing for the first time in a year, I'm singing in real time with Katie Geisinger and Allison Sniffen. And the technical thing is so overwhelming and exhausting. Like sometimes I think the computer is just this giant vampire that's like going, let me just take your energy. And, you know, to get this together is like so incredible. But to actually sing in real time with Allison and Katie, we're just, you know, it's incredible, you know. So even if we're, you know, can't quite hear each other, you know, but we're doing it. And so, you know, that's something to just be so grateful for. But we are waiting. We are really waiting. I'm sure you feel the same way.
Very much so. Very much so. And it's so interesting that, and I wonder if you feel the same way. We've shared with everyone that we experienced this incredible place, this ecosystem where we've been living in solitude in different ways. We didn't know that we were there together so close geographically. But how does that experience relate to this isolation?
Well, see, this is the interesting thing is I've been working on this piece called Indra's Net for 10 years. And the theme of that piece is, it's based on I guess originally it was Hindu/Buddhist, what they call a teaching story, you know, which is a story that, you know, that kind of illustrates, you know, a kind of spiritual principle. And this one is about interdependence. So the story is that Indra was an enlightened king, and he made a net that covered the entire universe. And at each intersection is a infinitely faceted jewel, which reflects all the other infinitely faceted jewels of the universe. So what it means is that anything that each of us does affects everything else. And so that principle, even in space, is something that I've been working on in terms of music, you know, music and images and everything. And I remember a few months before our pandemic beginning, I was talking to another wonderful person in my ensemble, Ellen Fisher, who will be teaching tomorrow. And I said, you know, this idea of this radiance, you know, I think we have to have a dark section of the piece of that kind of interdependence, like some kind of disease, I would say. And then here we are, you know. And so this idea that this whole world is experiencing, you know, some of the same thing just does offset this feeling of isolation, you know, and it really, really, you know, we have common experience and we have common suffering. And I think that is a way, again, of us having an understanding of, you know, other human beings and their experience. So in that way, if we use it well, and you know, and we know also that this world is so fragile, and I always say Mother Nature is just flexing her muscles. You know, how much abuse can she take before she, you know, this is just the tip of the iceberg. And I always think like the this, you know, one day I woke up, this was in the spring, and I woke up and I thought, this little tiny minuscule being that's wreaking havoc on the entire earth, you know, and it's so intelligent, you know, in a way you could say this entity that they're not saying is alive, but you know, I don't know what I would say about that. This entity, whatever it is, alive or dead, this intelligence and this efficiency is wreaking, this minuscule thing is wreaking havoc on the entire planet. You know, it's like, maybe we have to do hats off to it, because you know, in indigenous cultures, you give every part of nature its due and you ask for its mercy. You know, and there are many rituals for that. You know, and let's have respect for this thing. Do you know what I mean?
I very much know what you mean. And I think that it's actually not technically speaking alive. That's been discussed before. Of course, it depends on what alive is. Yeah, what alive is and what vantage point and maybe what discipline you're looking at it from.
Yeah.
But it is a mechanism.
It's a mechanism.
And mechanism is part of nature, and it is part of nature as we are part of nature, and nature is part of us. Of course, it doesn't have in and of itself a spiritual component. So
but it is nature, you know. So I feel like that's something to really, you know, think about in the largest terms. And hopefully that will, you know, it's like people just putting things together, you know. And I think I read something like intelligence is about connection. Let's see, you know, well, this is happening now. And, you know, is this connected to our behavior as human beings on the planet? I think so. You know, so, I mean, you know, it's sort of like, yeah. So let's hope that, you know, action is taken from that.
Yeah, we can only hope. And I think there is much hope, as you have said, as we both agree that there's much hope and there's light at the end of that tunnel and there are new adventures and journeys ahead. But personally, I hope that one of the lessons that individually and as a species that we learn is exactly what you said, the interconnectedness of all things.
Yeah.
And how even in isolation, we're profoundly connected.
Definitely.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that so much.
You're so welcome.
So now I'd like to ask you some questions from our students.
Will I see those beautiful faces today or not?
I only wish. No, it wasn't possible to do that because of the technological framework. I wish you could. In the future, we'll invite you back and introduce you to them. Gladly so. So here's a question from Jared Knight. In your early years, who were some of the most meaningful influences on your development as a composer?
I remember one time when I was 13 years old, I was in camp, and one of the teachers in her cabin played The Rite of Spring. I'll never forget that. I mean, I studied piano as a child, and I was very lucky that my piano teacher, I was not doing Thompson Book One, but I was doing Kabalevsky children's pieces. So I feel like my ear has always been attuned to that kind of that wonderful 20th century impulse. And I remember that it was like as if the doors of the universe opened hearing The Rite of Spring. I mean, I just couldn't believe it, you know, that could be. So that was a very huge influence. And then I think that Bartok, you know, a little bit later on, was also a very big influence, because I was did folk music when I was a teenager. I actually earned a little bit of money during the time I was going to Sarah Lawrence folk singing at children's birthday parties. So folk music, the honesty and plaintive, you know, and plangent quality of folk music has always something I'm very interested in. And so Bartok, the way that he worked with folk source, but then turned it into something that was so magical and that somehow seemed to just go through my bloodstream. You know, it's also, you know, somebody who was very important to me.
Beautiful. Thank you. And here's the question from Jonathan Sherpa. What counsel would you give to young composers who are unsure about whether they have found their artistic voice, and the young composer is struggling with believing in the value and worth of their own music?
Yeah, that I read that question. That is a very complex and beautiful question. You know, first of all, Jonathan, I really appreciate that you asked that question, that you know that part of the process of being an artist is finding your own artistic voice. You know, I think that sometimes people don't even, you know, they take what's out there, but they don't realize even your influences, you have to give yourself the time to integrate those influences and what I call sifted through what your own sensibility is, that's only you and no one else. You know, in other words, I always say there's only one of us in the universe. There's one Jonathan in the universe. And what does Jonathan have to give and have to say that no one else in the universe has to say? That takes time. It really takes time to find what's really, really truthful and that you haven't heard before. You know, it takes time to find that voice. You know, it really does. And I know it for me in my 20s, I think that it was life and death for me to find what my own artistic voice was. And there were some definitely big failures, you know, so it's a process. It's a process. But the fact that you asked that question means a lot to me that you are on the right track. And then it's, you know, and I know that for myself, if I look back, I wish that I had believed in myself a little bit more. You know, I had a lot of doubt and I still do to this day, you know, and in some ways I consider doubt also a good quality, because I think doubt is the way that you go back and question. And the people that don't doubt themselves, they just do product, you know, over and over and over and over again. And they've been told how wonderful they are and they make money and, you know, all that. That's a different way of thinking about things. But I think doubt from time to time is the way that you also renew. You know, I think that doubt sometimes comes in and then you got to find it again. You know, where are you now? You know, you're not just repeating. So I guess what I would say to you is just keep going. And then of course you have to present what you do. And there might be one or two people in your life that you trust. That's very important. You know, really see if you can surround yourself with people who will be honest with you and yet very supportive and whose ear you trust. Don't listen to the other people, you know, if you get bad reviews, if you respect that person and you might learn something from what that person has to say, cool. But you know, if that person is just vicious and you know, and it doesn't, and it's meaningless and it has more to do with them than it does with your work, throw it away, you know? So it's really a process of finding a few people that you would trust that would give you feedback about, Jonathan, I feel like you just went off your path a little bit there. I've had people in my life that have said that. I might have fought it in the beginning, but like a few hours later, I'm like, she's right. You know, I'm off my trolley a little bit. So, you know, it's more forming your belief in your process, your patience about going through the process, your wanting to find your own way, and then having a little bit few people on the outside that will help you, that will be honest and kind. I guess that's what I would say.
Great. Thank you so much for that beautiful answer. Very, very helpful.
It's easy to look back now, but you know, it's a struggle, boy. You know, I remember a lot of anguish, you know, as a young person, but it's worth it.
Indeed so, yeah. From Mitchell Davey and Abby Kellums, they asked the same question, but in a slightly different way. The role of the composer has always been subject to change throughout history. To what extent should a composer be engaged in social and or political activism? Do you consider yourself an activist, and in what ways?
Again, a wonderful question. Yeah, I mean, in some ways I do, because I feel like I've always been standing up for imagination standing up for the spirit of inquiry, standing up for, you know, pushing through to the other side of whatever the obstacle is. So that can, you know, that's a kind of, I think frankly, to be totally honest with you, making art in this society, you are an activist, just being an artist, you know, making, you know, just being an artist is an act of political power. You know, some people's work, and that's their truth, needs to be politically explicit, and it's very powerful, you know, and that's right for those people. Some people can give more by not being that specific and doing, you know, something, you know, doing more what I would say art is spiritual practice, but, or another way of thinking about things. So I think that that's, again, the question that each artist has to ask themselves: how can I be the most effective in this world to make a better world?
Beautiful. Thank you so much. This is a question about your legacy, and it's from Alex Didier. Many years from now, what in particular would you want people to most remember about you and your art?
I think it's a combination of liberation and rigor, liberation and discipline. And and if it has freed up other people, like to follow whatever their path is, and be curious, that would be a great legacy.
Wonderful. From Hannah Fulton, she would like to know, what activities and or environments do you seek out in order to inspire creativity?
Well, I think we talked about New Mexico. That's a, you know, real, I seek that out a lot. I read a lot, and I'm a real movie buff, like crazy, crazy movie buff. Like, you know, the history of film is one of my big inspirations, because I think, again, it has to do with the integrative nature of film and the way that it's, all the perceptions are like within one frame. The scale of film, you know, is something that I love. That's a big, you know, film is a big inspiration for me, you know, even if it's not a direct inspiration, you know, that particular film or that particular film, but the fact that you could see something like, for example, 2 years ago, I for some reason decided I wanted to look at the Apu trilogy again that I hadn't seen since I was in my early 20s, by Satyajit Ray, who's the Bengali filmmaker. And it was just a revelation to see it again, how, you know, so the film was made in the late 50s and it's three films. It was like, I just couldn't believe how relevant it was, you know, to me, and how deeply moving it was to me, you know, after all these years. So it still held, you know, after all these years. And so that's what I want my work to do, you know, or seeing Kurosawa films or Mizoguchi films or Ozu films or, you know, or Jean-Pierre Melville films, you know, these films are, I mean, it's just, there it is, you know, I mean, you could say the same thing certainly about beautiful pieces of music as well. So, you know, but I think it's that, you know, that somehow you see how, when you really get deep, it will always speak.
You mentioned Kurosawa, so I can't stop myself from asking, what do you think of Kurosawa's run, the chaos?
The later films, you know, I think they were more problematic. Dodeska Den, that's another later film. But he's probably the best choreographer that ever lived. I mean, the way that he, you know, his movement, sense of movement in the frame, the way the camera moves, and his choreography, you know, of battle. I mean, you know, I was thinking about him when I was doing this one scene, you know, so I've directed a feature length film, and, you know, wrote the music for it called Book of Days. And there was one scene in it that we called the marketplace scene. And it was a camera was slow panning back and forth. And it was like a half circle trajectory. And as it panned back and forth, different people would enter the frame. So you saw like the whole market scene, and it took I think a week to do it, you know, and it was, I thought of Kurosawa and I thought of Balanchine, like to choreograph, like, you know, as this camera was going, like who was coming from that side of the frame, who was coming in the frame, who was going out of the frame, who, you know, what was going on this time as it went this way. And then the camera went back that way. I think two or three times it went back and forth. And so, you know, just Kurosawa, it's kind of, I don't even have words for it. You know, just brilliant, man.
You're so right. I'm so glad you mentioned the battle scenes.
Yeah.
Because in Ron, they're so important on a variety of levels, not just because they're battles, they're emblematic of many things.
Yeah.
But choreography, it is just unbelievable how he was ever able to do that in that film.
And the Seven Samurai, you know, those battle scenes.
Yes. Oh.
Absolutely. Oh, unbelievable. Yeah.
But it's interesting, the parallel, you probably know Alexander Nevsky, the film of Prokofiev, and Eisenstein, and Eisenstein actually cut some of the film to the music. So it's an example of that. Mm-hmm. But the battle scenes in Alexander Nevsky are comparable to the ones in Ron. And again, it's this choreography, but it's in silent film. So it makes it very interesting how that could transcend any kind of language or any kind of verbal cue.
I love silent film. I mean, you have to sort of make yourself do it first to get in there. But it is, you know, I believe that the last silent filmmakers understood the language of images in a way that it took many, many years to get back to that sense of sophistication, because they understood the power of images, the rhythm of images. Like Murnau, some, you know, his films, and you know, there, I mean, just and von Sternberg, the, you know, his silent films. And so then when sound came in, it got very static because of the microphone, and it became more like filmed plays. Yeah. But you know, it's just that was the quintessential understanding of images, like a film like Sunrise that Murnau.
Yeah.
You know, it's astounding. So that's always been my goal as a filmmaker, you know, to think of my films almost as silent films, even though there is some text.
Yeah. I wondered what you would say about that, because I thought that was connected to your way of making film. And a question from Daniel Daly: how do you refine an idea before it is produced in its final medium? For example, how would you refine an in-process libretto before music, staging, lights, et cetera, are involved?
Well, again, I thought that was a very interesting question, because I never think libretto. So already I'm like, you know, I mean, but I'm not like against that question, but just, you know, my thing has been this iconoclastic thing of get rid of libretto. You know, so even making my opera Atlas, I consider the ersatz narrative, which is not really narrative, but as kind of, I thought of it more as a film scenario. So I don't work that way. You know, I actually work like a mosaicist. I work with all the elements. If it is a large work, not like, I work as a composer with just the music. And, you know, and the music is the heart of my work. And I work on music every day. So, you know, it's like that's my river of my life. But it takes a few years to accumulate, you know, the ideas for the larger works. That would be what Alexander is talking about. And but I think of all the elements as like tiles in a mosaic. So, you know, I'm working actually on all the elements simultaneously. That's more the way that I work.
Yeah, I should say that this composer who asked the question is composing a very large opera right now, having composed a chamber opera before. And he chose to remain in our program, and now a full-length opera, as a doctoral student before he was a master's student. So I think it came out of his own.
And was there a libretto? Did it start with libretto? See, that would be very hard for me on some levels. Although I must say there are like, for example, I was working on my piece Mercy. It was a collaboration with Anne Hamilton, did the visual images. She's a wonderful visual artist. And we were reading a lot. And there was a thing where I was reading a book and I knew that I wanted to make a scene in it about this woman during World War II that let in all these Jewish children and saved them. And it was in a little village in southern France, and everybody said what a hero she was. And she said, no, that's a natural thing to do. You know, why would you make such a big deal about it? You know, so I wanted, and I was at the piano and I was thinking about this woman at the door, and I wanted to make also a solo for Katie Geisinger. And so that was true, that scenario was in my mind. I was working on the music, but it wasn't that it didn't create the music. I think for me, I'm not able to work on music from a literal standpoint like that. It can help. I can make a dialogue back and forth with what a libretto would be. But then I just pray, you know, that it's going to have some kind of relationship. I sort of have to just let myself almost intuitively work on the music and then make the connection. Because if I try to be too literal, it doesn't work for me. You know, so that's just my personal thing. But maybe for Alexander, it is more, he can work more from a narrative, and that music comes from that. So everybody's got such a different way of working, you know, but I think that what I would say as an answer is that at certain point in your process, it's good to have all your ideas together, like I put it on a piece of paper, it's like a chart of here's my musical ideas that I have, here's my visual ideas, here's the libretto, here's the images, you know, it's so that you sort of see it as a whole, even as you go along. I don't know if that's helpful, Alexander, but that's the way I work.
Yeah, I think that's very helpful, seeing that I'm his advisor. So I think you've given
me. Because I feel like sometimes, you know, I get sick of narrative and words in opera, actually. They get in my way. You can't understand them anyway, mostly. And if it's too wordy, we just get lost, is what I've found.
Thank you so much. Here's another question. This is from Zhiwei Wang. And now we're in the realm of interdisciplinary art, which she says seems to be one of the mainstream directions within the development of music nowadays. What are your thoughts on the future direction of interdisciplinary performance and its relationship to music as an art?
I think it's a very healthy that musicians and composers are open to other input and other modes. And again, I think each person has got to find their own way. You know, some people will want to really just stay with that way of working on music as a very pure and focused kind of form. But I think this, you know, the idea that has opened up, one still has to be very rigorous and very disciplined to make it work. You know, it's not just throwing things together, and it's not just, oh, isn't it great we have film, or isn't it great, you know, there's images. That's not it. You know, in a way, you have to even be more disciplined to figure out how all those elements work together. It takes more discipline to make interdisciplinary work. It's not just it for itself. That's not enough. You know, you really have to figure out what kind of whole is this going to make? And, you know, because I think that's a danger. You know, everybody's like, oh, you know, I can use film, I can do lights, I can do this, I can do that, but it's not thought through. And then it just is kind of a hodgepodge.
Yeah, it can pull itself apart.
That doesn't have a lot of, you know, it just isn't powerful. And sometimes I think people get so involved with it that the other elements are very strong, but then they're not paying attention enough to the music. And sometimes I think also one has got to each piece figure out what the balance is. There are some pieces like, for example, there's a piece that I made called The Politics of Quiet in the mid 90s. And I came into rehearsal with a lot of the music done. And I kept on trying every kind of way of staging it and every kind of images and, you know, all kinds of images and all kinds of theatrical elements. And it didn't want it. It just did not want it. And so it came down to the performers also, it was after Atlas, and I was working with a lot of my remarkable singer actors that were in Atlas. And this piece did not allow them to do character. It was more, they were themselves. And it was more became, what it ended up being was a kind of nonverbal oratorio form in space with very geometric kinds of configurations. And that's what it ended up wanting. So everything doesn't have to be everything. You have to really figure out what does the piece want, and you have to spend a lot of time listening to what it wants. And each, and what I've enjoyed in my life, if one would say, what has given you the most enjoyment? For me, I love finding new forms. And usually I don't know what my form is until after I've made the piece. So it was, when the piece was finally made, I realized, oh, this is like a kind of an oratorio form, nonverbal oratorio choreographed kind of form, abstract, ritual, blah, 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 blah. I don't know what, you know, but I mean, that's what that, and I, you know, the reason I was saying this is I was just saw a documentary that someone had done of Claude Chabrol talking about Hitchcock and talking about how Hitchcock, you know, really found new forms in film. And I realized that's kind of what I've tried to do my whole life. It gives me pleasure, not knowing, and then finding it.
Thank you so much. We have one more question, and that is from Sarah Jordan. In light of what you know now, what advice would you give to yourself at the point when you were beginning your compositional career?
I think I would have just been kinder to myself and I would just say, dig thyself. That's what I would have said. You know, just have, you know, primordial self-confidence that you're just finding your way. And also, but I did learn this in experience, and for Sarah as well to know, is that sometimes what we think are our failures, we learn more from our failures than our successes. You know, really, if I think back, you know, where it was I made a piece that was a dismal failure. Usually the next piece, I found something and it came to life. So I would say, you know, what I wish that I had been able to say to myself is, this is okay. You know, this is part of the process. Let it roll off your back a little bit and then just keep going. You know, that's what I would say to myself as a young composer.
Thank you so much, Meredith. Before I thank you in a more complete way, I just want to invite everybody to the rest of this week. And we have an incredible number of what I know are going to be truly memorable events. Tomorrow at 1:30 to 3, we have the Dancing Voice Singing Body Workshop. I hope everybody will go to that. On Thursday, the 25th, from 4 to 5, a discussion between Meredith and Brian McWhorter, Associate Professor of Music, about Indra's Net, which you've heard Meredith talk about today. And then on Friday, from 2 to 3:30, this will be Meredith in discussion with the UL Faculty Ensemble about her work Backlight with question and answer. And then finally on Sunday, not to be missed, the live concert at 2:00. Do you want to say just a word about that before I thank you?
Trying to figure this out, like with the delay, even with the jamulus, with the delays, we went through our repertoire and there were some pieces we just cannot sing. It just can't be done in this technology. And I was going to sing Happy Woman as my last song, but we decided last rehearsal that enough was enough because I think in this format, you know, you just, it's hard for people to sit there for so long with the screen. So I'm sorry that I'm not singing that, but I just think it's better, you know, to shorten it a little bit. And there'll be four pieces from Cellular Songs and then some older material. And it's a trio concert, and we're looking really forward to it and hope that you all enjoy it.
I know that everybody will. We look forward to it so much, everything this week. And I want to thank you, Meredith, so much.
Thank you, Robert. It was a joy. Thank you.
Well, you've given us so much. I feel that your wisdom your humanity, and the way that you inspire us through your works, you also inspire us through your words.
Thank you.
You may think you're a nonverbal person, but I think part of you is verbal in a very eloquent way. And we've experienced that today. And it's given, I know everyone, as I'm seeing in the chat, great inspiration.
Thank you.
Thank you so
much. Lots of love to all you out there in virtual land from the Big Apple.
Thank you so much.
You're so welcome. Should I leave now? Is that what we do? Do we just leave the meeting?
I think we wait for another moment before we actually leave.
I'll just sit here then.
Yeah, just want to wish you all the very best for the entire week. I know it's going to be really great.
Thank you. Looking forward to it.